Good evening. Welcome to this service, Maundy, Thursday, when we remember the final night that Jesus shared with his disciples before he died. Tonight's service will conclude with the stripping of the altar, which is a symbol of Jesus' humiliation and vulnerability upon his betrayal and arrest. The service ends in silence. Please come back tomorrow night for the continuation of the story. Good Friday worship is at 7 p.m., and then join us on Easter Sunday at 10 a.m. as we celebrate his resurrection. Thanks to Tom Klemond and band for the music tonight. We continue with our gathering song.
El Shaddai, El Shaddai, El Elyon Adonai. Age to age, you're still the same by the power of the name. El Shaddai, El Shaddai, Ephraim Kana Adonai. We will praise and lift you high, El Shaddai. Through your love, save the soul. son of Abraham. Through the power of your hand, you turned the sea into dry land. To the outcast on her knees, you were the God who really sees. And by your might, you set the children free. El Shaddai, El Shaddai, El Elyon Adonai, age to age you're still the same, by the power of the name. El Shaddai, El Shaddai, Ephraim Kama Adonai, we will praise and lift you high, El Shaddai. That the time of Christ was near, though the people couldn't see what Messiah ought to be. Though your word contained the plan, they just could not understand. Your most awesome work was done through the frailty of your son. El Shaddai, El Shaddai, El Elyon Adonai, age to age you're still the same, by the power of the name. El Shaddai, El Shaddai, Ephraim Kana Adonai, we will praise and lift you high, El Shaddai. We will praise and lift you high, El Shaddai.
Within the community of the church, God never wearies of forgiving sin and granting the peace of reconciliation. On this night, let us confess our sin against God and our neighbor and enter these 3 days reconciled with God and with one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. Let us pray together. Holy God, source of all love, on the night of his betrayal, Jesus gave us a new commandment, to love one another as he loves us. Write this commandment in our hearts and give us the will to serve others as he was the servant of all. Your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
From Exodus, the 12th chapter. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall mark for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th of this month they are to take a lamb from each family, a lamb for each household. If a household is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join its closest neighbor in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat of it. This is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand, and you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord, for I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. On all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. When I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague shall destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be a day of remembrance for you. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord. Throughout your generations, you shall observe it as a perpetual ordinance. Here ends the reading.
Tonight's gospel is from Mark, the 14th chapter. On the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb is sacrificed, his disciples said to him, "Where do you want us to go and make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?" So he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him. And wherever he enters, say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large room upstairs, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there." So the disciples set out and went to the city and found everything as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, he came with the 12, and when they had taken their places and were eating, Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me." They began to be distressed and say to him one after another, "Surely not I." He said to them, "It is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the bowl with me. For the Son of Man goes as it is written of him, but woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born." While they were eating, he took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, gave it to them, and said, "Take, this is my body." Then he broke it, gave it to them, and said, "Take, this is my body." Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, and all of them drank from it. He said to them, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I tell you, I will never again drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." When they had sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives, and Jesus said to them, "You will all fall away, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered.' But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee." Peter said to him, "Even though all fall away, I will not." Jesus said to him, "Truly I tell you, this day, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times." But he said vehemently, "Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you." And all of them said the same. Here ends the gospel reading. Tonight, we remember the final meal Jesus shared with his disciples in the upper room. It's a chance for us to place ourselves around that table and imagine what it would have been like to be there, to understand what the disciples were thinking and seeing, and then finally, some 2,000 years later, to be part of that meal and receive the bread and wine. Most years, we place John's gospel account of this evening at the center of our reflections. John's gospel recalls Jesus washing the disciples' feet as a symbol of his final commandment to them to love one another. John doesn't spend as much time detailing the meal itself. Tonight we're reflecting on Mark's account, which details the mood and conversation that took place around the meal. And he speaks about some of the events that occurred as they finished the meal and moved to the Garden of Gethsemane. In preparation for the Passover, Jesus sends two disciples, as we heard, to go and make preparations for the meal. Mark doesn't say which two. According to Luke's gospel, it was Peter and John, two of his closest disciples. Mark's gospel reports that in the days leading up to Passover, the religious authorities are looking for a way to arrest Jesus by stealth and to kill him. But they want to be quiet about it. They don't want to do it during the Passover itself when all the crowds are on Mount Zion and at the temple for the festival because they are afraid of a riot. They want to stay in control. Jesus was quite popular, so they're on the lookout. Jesus knows this, so they have to be discreet. Peter and John are told to follow a man carrying a jar of water. Carrying water was something women did more commonly. This would have been unusual for a man, so it was something that would be easy to spot, a secret sign. The Syrian Orthodox Church today that maintains the monastery of St. Mark in Jerusalem suggests that the upper room was located there in that monastery in the upstairs of Mark, the gospel writer's house at the time. Some have suggested that this may be the same space where the disciples hid after Jesus was killed, where the disciples were told to wait for the Holy Spirit at Pentecost, and then where the apostles met in the early years of the church. None of that is definitive. But there have also been some historical questions about the precise timing of the meal and whether this was a regular dinner or the Passover meal, but Mark's gospel does state that the meal begins in the evening, which marks the beginning of Passover, so Mark clearly identifies this as a Passover meal. As two of Jesus' most trusted disciples are making quiet preparations for the meal, Judas has been making his own quiet plans. He's contacted authorities and agreed to be paid to hand Jesus over. Some who know how the seating would have taken place in the early centuries have suggested it's very likely Judas was seated right next to Jesus at the place of honor. When Jesus talks about the betrayer dipping his bread into the bowl with him, it would be someone seated next to him. And in a Passover meal, the dipping happens twice. The bread is dipped once into salt water as a reminder of the salty tears of slavery in Egypt. And then the bread is dipped a second time in bitter herbs as a reminder of the bitterness of slavery in Egypt. And so Jesus and Judas dip their bread together into bowls that are reminders of the tears and bitterness of Israel's slavery and history. In doing this, we're reminded of Psalm 41:9, when Jesus' ancestor David wrote, "Even my close friend, someone I trusted, one who shared my bread, has lifted up his heel against me." It's worth reflecting a bit on what a Passover meal was like. What we now celebrate as Holy Communion is not a Passover meal, but Jesus began a new meal and sacrament of Holy Communion based on elements of the Passover meal. The whole purpose of the Jewish Passover celebration is to help those at the meal remember God's deliverance of the people of Israel from slavery in Egypt. The people cried out to God for deliverance from slavery, and God heard and delivered them. They were taken through the wilderness to the promised land. And for Jewish people, deliverance from slavery in Egypt is the most formative story historically. By the end of the meal, everyone remembers and experiences that they are free. It's not only a retelling, but over the course of the meal, the purpose is for each person to personally experience the movement from the bitterness of oppression to the sweetness of salvation so that they can savor the great things that God has done for them. The Passover meal is all about telling the story of God's relationship with his people throughout history. But it's more than a story, it's an experience, and at each meal these words are spoken. In every generation, each person should see themselves as if they were slaves in Egypt. In a typical Passover meal, it was not just once, but there were actually four separate times when the ritual order of the meal that participants would have drank from the cup of wine. And these four times represented the four promises God had made to the Israelites that God would redeem them. In Exodus 6, verses 6 and 7, God said, "I will bring you out from Egypt. I will free you from slavery. I will redeem you with my power. I will take you as my own people." That third promise and that third cup of wine was the cup of redemption, which represents the blood of the Lamb at the original Passover in Egypt. Death would pass over those who trusted in him and let the blood of the Lamb be spread across their doorposts. At this Last Supper, Jesus said, "This is my body," and he took the cup probably that third time and said, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many." Jesus takes the opportunity of the Passover meal to help his disciples see that he will become a new Passover lamb, the sacrifice that will allow death to pass over them. Jesus will redeem them. But more personally, it's a meal that we're now invited to allow us to be freed from sin and death. Jesus has redeemed us. The blood of the covenant also brings to mind Moses in Exodus 24, who, after reading the Ten Commandments and the First Covenant, sprinkled the people with blood as a way of sealing that covenant. Now it's the blood of Jesus which initiates this new covenant. Jesus is telling us, "I will bring you out of your slavery to sin and death. I will free you. I will redeem you. I will take you as my own people." In communion, we're invited not just to hear the story, but to experience Christ's suffering and be moved to the joy of freedom and new life. Communion is a time for sober reflection, but ultimately a time for confident joy to celebrate our freedom in Christ. At the Last Supper, Jesus told his disciples that all of them would desert him, and they all denied it. Peter was confident he would stand firm. We know he didn't. Jesus left them with the gift of his grace in an enduring meal, but he also spoke frankly with them about their weaknesses. They all denied it, but Jesus was the one who spoke truthfully and saw things clearly. Communion is a time to reflect honestly on our own weaknesses, our sin, and our failure to follow in faith, even in the ways we intend to help and serve our neighbors, to love God above all those things that only serve to undermine our own humanity and peace and justice in the world. The good news is that God's grace is greater than our weakness. This meal is finally a moment of victory and joy. It's a time to celebrate the incredible gift of Christ's sacrifice for each one of us and his readiness to go ahead of us and welcome us as his disciples again. In a few minutes, you'll be invited to recall God's saving work in your life, to think of yourself as a slave who has now been freed by Jesus Christ. As we finish the meal today, we leave with confidence in God's love and forgiveness for us because of his sacrifice. Amen.
Take and eat, take and eat. This is my body given up for you. Take and drink, take and drink. This is my blood given up for you. I am the word that spoke and light was made. I am the seed that died to be reborn. I am the bread that comes from heaven above. I am the vine that fills your cup with joy. Take and eat, take and eat. This is my body given up for you. Take and drink, this is my blood given up for you. I am the way that leads the exile home. I am the truth that sets the captive free. I am the life that raises up the dead. I am your peace, the peace my gift to you. Take and eat, take and eat. This is my body given up. I am the lamb that takes away your sin. I am the gate that guards you night and day. You are my flock, you know the shepherd's voice. You are my own, your ransom is my blood. Take and
we join together in speaking our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for this night as we gather to remember your final meal with your disciples and all that you gave to them. We ask you to be with us this night. And as we reflect on your betrayal, on your arrest, grant us peace this night as we recall your saving grace and your love poured out for each one of us. All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. And I'll stand my soul, Lord, to you surrender. All I am is yours. And I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe. The one who gave it all, and I'll stand my soul, Lord, to you surrender. All I am is yours. So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned, being all. So I'll stand with arms high. can I say? What can I do? What can I do? Offer this heart, oh God, completely to you.
As Jesus gathered with his disciples that final night, we are surrounded by all the faithful of every time and place, and by Jesus himself as we share in this meal tonight. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." We join in the prayer that Jesus taught. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The table is ready. All are welcome. Please come. Be sure to take a cup as you come forward down the center aisle, and they can be placed on the tables on the side aisles as you return to your seats.
Shadows deepen, we do. Do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through? We do. Do you wish that you could see it all made new? We do. Is all creation groaning?
It is.
Is a new creation coming?
It is.
Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst?
It is.
Is it good that we remind ourselves of this? Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slain. Does the Father truly love us?
He does.
Does the Spirit move among us?
He does.
Does the Jesus, our Messiah, hold forever those he loves.
He does.
Does our God intend to dwell again with us? He does. Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah who conquered the grave. He is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. Is he worthy? Worthy of all blessing and honor and glory. Is he worthy? Is he worthy? Is he worthy of this? He is.
May the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace, now and forever. Amen. Lord Jesus, in a wonderful sacrament, you strengthen us with the saving power of your suffering, death, and resurrection. May this sacrament of your body and blood so work in us that the fruits of your redemption will show forth in the way we live. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.